Govind Swarup and Yashpal, they were the initial people who welcomed us and, you know, made our stay comfortable, and they would involve us in their social occasions. And I would have most of my discussions, you know, with Govind Swarup, because he was interested in pulsars, which were just detected then. I got into neutron star physics at that time, and that interested Govind Swarup, and we worked together. Pulsars were just recently discovered in 1967. So he said, Kumar, let's build a model. Unfortunately, we were barking up the wrong tree. But he kept his interest. He would just walk into your office and ask what was going on. And he was a very curious intellectual who was always willing to learn. And that's what I admired about Govind Swarup. See, he was my teacher, he was my mentor. At the same time, I could see the enthusiasm with which he was driving his group. So Ooty telescope came up in 1970s. And at that time, he was thinking about next project. So I said to Govind, I could take that liberty. Govind, you are a very restless, creative individual. Not that Ooty had just become operational. You are thinking of a giant meter wave radio telescope, GMRT. He actually was thinking of first the giant equatorial radio telescope, GERT program, which is what Bahia alluded to. And then he conceived of GMRT. And I recall distinctly when he submitted the project, GMRT project, to DAE, Dr. Ramanna was the chairman of Atomic Energy Commission. He invited me and Narlikar as experts to comment. And this was in the old yacht club. Govind made the presentation. And then Ramanna asked us to make, and we made encouraging noises, how it is worthwhile to support this project, where Govind had asked for only 30 crores for the entire GMRT project. And the only comment Ramanna made was, Govind, you're being a baniya. Why are you so tight-fisted in asking for only 30 crores? We'll give you 50 crores. And sure enough, GMRT project eventually ended up with 50 crore tag. It was Govind's regret, let me share with you, that we could not get work of that kind produced, which is Nobel Prize worthy. And that's what he used to privately mourn, that we are not applying enough intellectual energies to pull work of that magnitude, of that class, of that quality. For we do competent work, of course, competent science, but not the same Nobel Prize timber class. Not that we did not have. Govind Swarup, in my view, deserved a Nobel Prize for having built up the radio telescopes of the kind at Ooty and at GMRT. And now, later on, see, Govind Swarup was a restless intellectual. He knew never stay quiet. I'm sure even in eternity, now that we have lost him, he's thinking of another project. See, that was Govind's restless intellect. Anyway, Square Kilometer Array was the next project on his card. I hope his group, the radio astronomers, would take the initiative forward. It's about time that the kind of facilities which people like Siddiqui and Govind Swarup have delivered for us, we had to push it to an extent that they, that will do them proud. And we have young workers in radio astronomy and in molecular biology, who have the intrinsic capability of delivering science of that class. So that's my philosophy. Anyway, we have lost Govind Swarup. I lost my teacher and my mentor. May his soul rest in peace. But I'm sure it will be a restless soul. Because Govind Swarups of this world, they never rest. They're always thinking in their mind of the next project they should work on. But Govind, we will keep your flag flying here. Thank you.
I met him because I was setting up the TIFR archive. Around October 2004, I came to TIFR, and in January, I started interviewing Professor Swarup. I happened to interview three or four of them who started. There were four radio astronomers who had written to Bhabha. Yes. So I happened to, you know, talk to all of them. You know, and Professor Swarup was very encouraging. He said, no, you must talk to all of them. Only I shouldn't tell you what our history is. So you see, he had that sense of, you know, being fair, of, you know, putting all of that together in a way that was, you know, interesting. One thing that really affects him is nationalism. And he actually goes to school on the 8th of August, 1942, even if his mother, though his mother didn't want him to go to school. And because that was the day Gandhi had called for Quit India. He said, but I wanted to go to school and I wanted to say Quit India in school with everybody. And so, and he was about 13. And he said, then we went on a procession and there was, the police started shooting on us. And he says, that really stayed with me, that this was a school procession that was not threatening anybody. It was just, you know, children coming out because Gandhi had given the call and, you know, they were shooting. So I think, you know, that had he obviously someone very much, you know, interested in how India looks to the world. That's why when he talks about radio astronomy, he wants to talk about this larger thing. You know, India, and not just you know, himself. We were talking one day, and he was saying that, you know, why do you think young people don't come into science? What is it that they want, you know? So I said, well, you know, maybe they want to be paid much more. They want to, you know, to go abroad. He kept quiet. He didn't say anything. The next day when I came, he said, you know, I thought of what you were saying. See, I can tell young people about my experience. See, the thing is, I also went abroad. I got a car. I had enough money. So, you know, science can get you the same thing.
Great.
And he was smiling. But the thing is, what he didn't see is the scale, you know, the kind of car, the kind of money, the kind of greed we've all been infected with is not something Govind Swarup could even comprehend, because he was so dedicated to his science and a very innocent man in that sense. He was not someone who said, I must get this much of recognition, this much of money. No. That's what, you know, his smile is very much, thanks for asking that, because I think, you know, it very much tells you what kind of man he was. Very, very innocent. And there was Krishnan and Swarup and T.K. Menon and Mukul Kundu. Now, they send their proposal. They plan to send it to UGC, to CSIR, to NPL, Committee for Space Research. And then T.K. Menon told me that they had first thought they'll send it to D.S. Kothari, who was chairman of UGC, and to the Director General of CSIR, which was M.S. Thacker. But Vainu Bapu, who T.K. Menon happened to meet at that same, you know, conference, he took a walk with Vainu Bapu, who said, why don't you send it to Dr. Bhabha? Because only then something will happen.
Wow.
And till then, they hadn't thought of sending it to Bhabha. He comments on his meeting with Bhabha. He meets Bhabha about this and he says, you know, this is what we want to do. And Bhabha says, yes, go ahead. But Bhabha's approach is something that surprises Swarup. So I'll quote from what Swarup tells me. He says, I asked him if I needed to write a project proposal. I had written a scientific proposal, but a project proposal requires you to give the budget. He said, young man, don't waste your time.
Yes.
Form a group. When you have formed a group, we will approve your project. Correct. So it became very important to form a group. So you see, it was not really like this way of writing a project down. And, you know, you have to get the budget approved and run from pillar to post. No, Bhabha didn't want that. And for me, the oral history interviews, they're so intense and so long that they create that connection. So when that person goes away, and when I was reading my interview with him, I was smiling, laughing to myself for the things he had said, but also remembering him very warmly. So that connection stays, I think. So my, you know, deepest condolences to the family.
Now, Europe and other countries are still wondering about radio astronomy. Some fine leadership in Australia had put radio, Australia very quickly up in the charts of radio astronomy. And Govind Swarup was right there in the middle of the topmost work being done in radio astronomy and was involved in a whole series of telescopes that were developed in radio astronomy. There were all kinds of designs that were tried, all kinds of shapes that were tried. And because Australia has the sky that other regions don't, a lot of very exciting new astronomy that came out. Pulsars are there, all kinds of objects came out from that study. Then he was not a man to settle saying that, no, okay, Routy radio telescope, so much science has come and now I will go. He was thinking of bigger things even while he was at Routy. And his great dream of the great dream was that the best thing you can do is to use African land, American money and Indian brains to create what will be the world's largest telescope. And he wanted to build a giant equatorial telescope in Kenya, right at the equator, so that it could look at the southern sky and northern sky. And he spent a lot of his energy trying to develop this giant equatorial telescope, which would have been a great achievement at that time. But various political and other developments meant that his dream was not to be satisfied, and he always remained unhappy because of that. He eventually went on to he was at AFR, and because the idea of this giant equatorial telescope was fantastic, India decided to adopt it. Govind Swarup decided to build an equivalent telescope in India, which is the giant meter wave radio telescope. If you travel from Pune to Nashik, you can see that entire site. It consists of 30 dishes of 40 meters each, spread over an area of 1,000 square kilometers. It's an equivalent disk of 1,000 square kilometers existing in Pune-Nashik Road, and which is one of the largest radio telescopes in the world. And even today, at lower wavelengths where GMRT works well, remains the largest radio telescope of that kind. So the breadth of this imagination was not only restricted to radio astronomy, but the entire breadth of astronomy. And he continued to work on all aspects of astronomy. Also, you must remember that he was working on high-class, world-level electronic instrumentation at a time when Second World War had just ended, and you were still working with valves and transistors to make your equipment. And Indian industry was practically non-existent. Indian industrial base was practically non-existent, and he had to make these instruments, and he didn't like imports. He always invariably made everything that he wanted. So he and I know of a couple of other colleagues of his time who would go to Chor Bazar, and all the Second World War electronic equipment that had been brought for Second World War and which had simply been scrapped in various bazaars of Mumbai lying as scrap, he picked up from there, got whatever he wanted, and built his instruments in TFR. All his sensitive radio telescope equipment, everything was built in-house by him and his team, and when necessary he used industry's help, but he knew exactly the inside out of everything that he did. That is the kind of perception depth and insight and the desire to make in India at a time when making in India was considered impossible because we didn't have an industrial infrastructure. In 60s and 70s, it was so much weaker. But Govind Swarup remained Indian at heart to the extent that he insisted that these kind of things would be made in Indian industries. He was India-centric in his work, he was India-centric in his thinking, and he was capable of unbelievable imagination and had the ability to carry it out and deliver it. At a time when India needed confidence that they could build anything they wanted and they could work on anything they wanted, Govind Swarup was the man who proved to the world that Indians sitting in India could do anything they wanted, and in many, many ways gave us the pride and confidence on the basis of which it was the moral confidence that he gave on the basis of which TFR and India went to make other major instruments and equipment. But Govind Swarup was the first and will remain the first person to take up gigantic projects and build them in India with Indian resources and Indian capabilities. An Indian at heart, an Indian at work, an Indian at in every sense of the word, who put India on the world map and changed the face of radio astronomy.
So the grief that I feel because of him passing is really inconsolable. However, his memories would always stay with me, and you know, keeps giving me so much of positivity and make me realize that if I was so lucky to have such a person as my mentor to guide me, there's nothing else that I could ask for. He was really keen about astronomy outreach, and so this one time we were going to Department of Science and Technology, Central Government of India, to tell them about our work. And so we were going to have this final presentation in front of the panel at DST to give us a grant about science popularization project that we had in mind. And Dr. Swarup asked me to come to his residence and talk about that project. So I went there, and me and my colleague had prepared a big presentation which was supposed to have only 5 slides and explain the whole thing that we were going to do for the project. And Dr. Swarup was very disappointed at me, and he really scolded both of us that you're having this presentation in front of such a huge government body, and you have to be more thorough, you have to make even more better presentation. And he really scolded us. I mean, that's what we expect the mentors to do, right? Not just tell us how good we are doing, but also tell us where we are lacking. And he did exactly that for us. And we were really disappointed because we disappointed him. But when we reached home, I had received an email from him in which I was kept CC. And he had sent the mail directly to the DST as the recommendation letter for us. So he used to always say that more people should get into astronomy and the government should focus on it more, not just the research, but also the outreach. He was really into finding the extraterrestrial life, and he was really passionate about that. He told me that GMRT is our tool in India that we can use to find the extraterrestrial life. But when I asked him why we are not taking it up, he said that if people were to take up this field to find extraterrestrial life, there should be enough funds available. If government looks into it as much, the funds will be available and people will get into this field and do it, just like SETI. So, you know, he could connect with us young generation. He always told me that he liked to talk with me and my colleagues, and he always loved to talk with the younger generation. He used to say that it keeps him updated about what's going on in the world right now. And so, you know, whenever I met him, even at the age of 90 that I met him last on his birthday, he was really enthusiastic, and he asked me to take a selfie with him. I gifted him a little painting that shows how astronomy is reaching to common man, and he was really impressed with that. So there are so many memories about him that I can share, and this was such a legend and such an amazing person that India was lucky to have. He was also one of the fellow of the Royal Society in the UK not Royal Astronomical Society, but the Royal Science Society. And when I went to UK, they have this big book in which there are all the signatures of the people who have been the fellow of the Royal Society of England. And Dr. Raghunath Mashalkar is also a fellow. Dr. Govind Swarup is also a fellow. Darwin was also fellow. So, Dr. Govind Swarup had done this signature in the book that I got to saw when I went to the UK. In the same book, there is signature of Darwin as well. So you can realize what level this person had. And I will always, keep his memories in my heart. And I hope that me doing this work, me reaching out to you guys, he's one of the star stuff now, and he's looking up to us, looking down to us, whatever it is, and hope he is always amongst us as a star stuff.